What up, people? Pushing Wild Black here, and this is going to be my second in a interview series I'm going to start. So, this brother, I've met him through Facebook, through one of my associates through Facebook, and he's been a very influential person as far as my education from police brutality in the disability community, and as well as black and disabled studies, and just generally just some cool information that's come across my way. Rapper, poet, disability rights activist Leroy Moore is with me on the line. Leroy, how you doing, sir?
I'm doing good. Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. Well, my first question isn't necessarily on my list here. Based on the election, are you going to come back to America after you leave for South Africa?
I'm coming back. Yeah, this is my home. My family's here. My friends are here. But yeah, it does look, tempting to stay in Africa. But I'm coming here. The struggle continues. I'm here for the fight.
I understand what happened. I don't think everybody else did. It was because I did the opinion polls before. I actually worked as a pollster. So I would call you, and I would ask you, what are you voting for? I would ask you what issues hit your America. And when you call Florida, and when you call Iowa and Idaho, and you listen to, because when you're taking phone calls, you have to be, impartial. So if they want to get racial, you have to kind of like, all right, you kind of have to laugh with them when they tell an Obama joke. So it's like I was very keen into what could happen. I didn't realize it was going to be, because, I figured we would come up and we would vote enough. But I guess the voice of the working class or the poor white person was loud and clear.
One thing is, it's going on social networks is the electoral college, because the popular vote, didn't go to Donald Trump,
Yeah.
So that right there is a real mix-up. I'm a third-party kind of guy, so I don't go for the two-party system. But we have to really look at that. The Democrats really shot themselves in the foot in the beginning, because Clinton, we started that, she's a woman. She didn't have a really chance, because she lost to Obama. so she wasn't really a strong candidate for the Democratic Party from the beginning.
I think they go in the cycles, because I was just talking to one of my friends this morning about, because I mentioned to him, I was like, is Trump white America's Obama? And how I based that on is, you look at the situation of Obama's election, because it's been I have this theory that Obama just kind of came out of nowhere.
Really. I was there at the DNC like 8 years ago in Boston, and nobody knew about Obama.
Right.
No matter of fact, Clinton was there and brought Obama up to the stage, at the African American caucus, and everybody's like, "Who is that?"
Right.
So Obama came out of nowhere. And people can't compare Obama to Clinton, because Obama came out of nowhere. Clinton has a history.
Right.
long history.
Right.
Yeah, I think that history really tainted her to become president. And I think the Democratic Party knew that, but said, okay, what the hell? It's her time.
Right.
So they really shot themselves in the foot.
And then they, by them basically exiting out Bernie Sanders, I was like, what are they doing? Like without and I don't want this to be a complete and total podcast about the election, but
for them to just
take Bernie Sanders and was like sabotage his actual campaign, when to the Republican Party's credit, when they saw the Tea Party gain momentum, because I'm always hearing about how there can't be a third party candidate, and I'm like, but there is, but there was, because when you look at Obama's election, you know, the Republican Party, the people of the party thought that the Republican Party let them down, so the rise of the Tea Party came after that.
Yeah.
And then what the Republican Party did, which to their credit was smart, it was like they saw that Tea Party candidates were getting votes in certain states. So they were just like, okay, come on back. We're gonna include you in the party now. So what I think needs to happen, to be honest, is they need to, like, use this as an opportunity, the Democratic Party, because there's going to be third-party candidates now. You know, I'm not a Democrat nor a Republican. I'm kind of leaning towards libertarianism. And there needs to be, like, people that are going to make a third party, not necessarily strong, but at least stronger than it is. And then the Democratic Party needs to take lessons from that. But I don't know, especially as Black people, I don't know if we'll be, you know, able, forward thinking enough to just say, okay, are we going to take some L's politically for a few cycles and build a third party so at least the Democratic Party is paying attention? Because it seemed like to me Hillary Clinton wasn't even paying attention to running. Trump was everywhere and Hillary Clinton was kind of pandering to us.
Yeah, I mean, The whole party just gave in and said, okay, Clinton's gonna be the number one choice. And because the Clintons thought they had a stronghold on African Americans, it's like, oh, we don't really need the campaign. I mean, this is what, the last what, 2 or 3 weeks, they got like what, they got Jay-Z and Beyonce. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
You know, that's not the Black community.
Or the Breakfast Club interview. The Breakfast Club interview was another one where I was like, really?
Yeah,
it's
like, come on, you know?
Yeah, I think it was utterly lazy, and I think there needs to be some soul searching within the party. I also think, and I said this in a Facebook video, I think we need to get rid of the Electoral College, but the idea that I'm seeing with a lot of people, well, we need to petition the electors from the college to go rogue and not do their job. We're already in a Democratic Republic as it is, so we're completely going to be a republic now? You know, like, I'm not a fan of Trump either, but I think the best course of action for us as a community, you know, Black, white, Hispanic, you know, in a liberal democratic community, I think we need to go to the polls in 2018 and actually weaken his Congress. Because I learned with the Obama presidency that Congress is really important, and those mid-cycle elections are really important, because it makes no sense that he could have got a lot more done, and he did a lot with what he was handed, but it makes no sense that he had a Congress that was working with him for 2 years. So I think we as people need to, if you're really mad about the situation, I think you need to, you know, let your voice heard at the other in the other election too, and kind of make his, you know, term a little harder right now. Because I was telling people, you do realize if Hillary even wins, she does have a Republican Congress, and we don't know how they're going to work with her.
Yeah.
So, but I did wanted to ask you about the South Africa trip, though. You were supposed to go this month. What happened?
So, you know, the South Africa trip, it's not only a trip. It's been on my radar for the last 6-7 years, almost 8 years, 10 years. You know, I've been wanting to go to South Africa since I was in high school back in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been building up to this point. In the last 10 years, I've been, Krip Hop has been connecting with a lot of Africans with disabilities, not only South African, but all over Africa.
Right.
So we've been building up to this point. And as a matter of fact, what, almost 2 years ago, we had a campaign, an Indiegogo campaign, to raise money for, two daughters with disabilities, they needed wheelchairs.
Mm-hmm.
So we had a campaign that was in Uganda. You know? So, you know, I say that because, you know, people was like, oh, you know, Krip Hop is going and stuff. I was like, no, this has been, you know, the lead up to it. You know, we just didn't wake up yesterday and think, oh, we're going to go to South Africa.
Right.
So, you know, because of that, I've been staying in contact with Simon. Simon is the news editor of the, what's called Disability Now newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been contacting with him and a lot of, you know, South African disabled musicians and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we talked, you know, earlier this month, and we said, you know, really, the sponsorship wasn't there yet.
Right.
So we was like, okay, let's, you know, because I was like, you know, should we cancel it? And so everybody's like, no, let's postpone it. So we just postponed it until December 1st until the 28th.
Okay.
And it seems like more people are coming on board, more sponsors coming on board. So he was a good choice to postpone it.
Okay. So what is the tour like that? It's a tour, right? So what is the tour going to encompass? Like, is it more of an advocacy type of thing, or is it music, or is it a little bit of both?
Yeah, it's both. It's really both. The tour is really connecting with South Africans with disabilities, you know, really talking about our struggles, our culture, our art, you know. So at the same time, coming out of the tour with a film documentary and a book.
Wow.
So it's two-fold kind of tour. It's really, one fold is, you know, conversation, education, advocacy, and another form is cultural expression and coming out of it with a book in a film. And also, we want to build on this tour for 2 years down the line. We've been trying to get contact with Stevie Wonder.
Yeah.
He has a really big international disabled musicians networking tour. So that is, so, you know, everything builds on everything else.
Right.
So, like I said, this tour is not only, you know, one event and go home and that's it. It's really building on our connections there in South Africa and in Africa, and also to build up for, you know, what, 2017 or 2018?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So you and Keith are the co-founders of Krip Hop Nation. I know it's not a label, It's more of an artist collective, but can you kind of explain your motivation and what it originally started to be? Was it a, was it going to be a label, or was it always kind of like in a collective?
Yeah, it originally started, next year will be our 10th anniversary. So it really started when I was a young boy, and plus I didn't have the politics and the vision for it. But as a young boy, I used to go downstairs of my family's house. We had a basement back in Connecticut, and my father had this huge record collection. And I used to go through this record collection, and I saw a lot of black disabled musicians, from the blues, you know, flying blues singers to soul singers like, you know, Robert Winters and, you know, all that. So when I saw that, I was like, wow, you know, because as a black boy with a disability, back in the '80s, you know, you go to school and nobody's gonna teach you about your history. You know, matter of fact, they didn't even know that black disabled people had a history.
No.
So that's where I first got my a mirror that really looked like me. You know, all of my identities, not only black, but it really looked like me as a black disabled man. Robert Winters had a cover where he's standing with his crutches and just posing. I was like, oh my God, you know, that's me, you know.
Right.
So, you know, so from there until now, you know, I didn't let go of it. You know, I just didn't, you know, make it public. But when Krip Hop really became public, it was in 2007, where we did the 3-part radio series on hip hop and disability. And after that 3-part series, I went on MySpace. This is, you know, back when MySpace was hot.
Right.
There was no Facebook at the time.
Right.
So it was on MySpace, and I just wrote up, you know, a call to action, you know, and that's how it started. You know, artists from all over started to email me and things like that. And me and Keith Jones and Rob the Noise Temple really sat down, you know, and said, you know, what Krip Hop will be. And we all knew that we didn't want to put our lifeline on the music industry.
Right.
You know, Rob the Noise Temple is an elder of Krip Hop. He's been around since the 70s, so he knows the music industry. And we all knew that the music industry is so fickle when it comes to disability. So we said, you know, let's have this as a network, you know, where disabled musicians can come and go and do their thing, and we can advocate and all that stuff. So, you know, since that time, we put out three CDs.
Right.
International. We have artists from Spain, all around Europe. I just interviewed 2 artists from Brazil, you know, so it's not only the U.S., it's international.
Were you able to go to Brazil, or you just
left? That's the next tour that we're going to talk about it in the new year, you know, so we're talking about it.
Now, you had mentioned, because, you know, I always read the stuff you post on Facebook, and you had mentioned, like, because the Olympics and the Paralympics just happened over the summer in Brazil,
yeah.
And you were always saying how basically the disabled population in Brazil, they got shafted, basically.
Yeah, basically, and, you know, that's why I interviewed 2 artists, because, you know, of course, I didn't want to put that out with my own voice. I wanted to get the voice from the people. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the Olympics have a long history of, you know, going into the city and just totally taking us all the resources and sweeping people out of their community. So, you know, it happened in London and, you know, 4 years ago, and it happened in, Rio, you know, a couple months ago. So I see two disabled hip hop artists, you know, about that, and of course about the music, you know. I'm trying to get in contact with this disabled activist in São Paulo, Brazil. Mm-hmm. She's radical, and I love her politics. And she really tells the truth about Brazil and about how, you know, how people with disabilities can't even get into City Hall. You know, forget about the Olympics. They can't even get into buildings, you know.
Like pre-ADA here.
Yeah, they have laws on the books, but, you know, it's not implemented, you know. So it's a show and tell, you know. It's a tell part about it, but there's no show about it.
Right, as it tends to be with laws on the books. I have issue with the Americans with Disabilities Act, but I don't really like to say it publicly because I'll be seen as radical if I say too much. But just as a person that's pre-ADA, and I'm not going to say that it's ridiculous because it's not, but just noticing how it was before and noticing how, you know, accessibility is now, and I'm not saying that the law is bad, but just by me pushing in a wheelchair every day, I can honestly say I'm like, what are we celebrating every year?
I say that a lot, you know. I say that a lot when July comes. You know, I used to have this nonprofit back in the 90s called Disability Advocates of Minorities Organization for Disabled People of Color. Mm-hmm. And every year, for 4 years, we used to have what's called the Other Side Rally.
Yeah.
During the year. So we had people of color, we had people that were quote-unquote immigrants that were disabled. You know, we had, you know, poor people that are living in shelters that were disabled.
Right.
You know, so we had the whole group coming out to say that, you know, the ADA is not, you know, it's not a utopia kind of thing. It's been really implemented that really affects, you know, people of color and people that are poor.
I just think that the advocacy model is the... I'm just going to go radical for 5 seconds.
Yeah, go.
the advocacy model of what white disability advocacy is let's sue everybody. Which, like, I'm from Chicago, so...
Okay.
I have issue with... I'm in Dallas now, but I have issue with the people suing Uber, with Access Living in Chicago suing Uber, when... It's like the last time I was home, because I tried to live to go back home because my mom is there and my family's there, and my mom's in her 60s now. So I tried to go back home to live, and there's no jobs. I tried, and then when, you know, 3 months out the year, you can't get out your house.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And I'm like, I'm reading articles, and they're still doing stories on local news about how certain areas of the city, minority areas, are not getting, like, you know, care as far as shovel, as far as salt in the sidewalks, and people can't get out their house, but y'all want to sue Uber. It's like, really? And then when you mention, okay, Uber is not a transportation company, it's an app company.
Yeah.
We really could, the people that are responsible for that lawsuit, it's like, Chicago's one of the few places in this, like, they used to call, California's the Mecca for disabled people. That's where you go, that's where it's
more. Oh, yeah,
But I know it's not, because we'll get into your advocacy point in a minute. But as far as, like, that's the second place where we're supposed to be, as far as like disability pride parades and all this stuff. So you have an advocacy group that they know a lot about the culture there. And I know for a fact that there are disabled people that can drive. I know for a fact that there are, like, you know, people that work in the disability economy where they could have easily just decided, okay, we're going to use Uber. And this is just me speaking as a marketer. That's what my background is, design and marketing. You could easily just take, you know, Uber and use it as a platform to build an economy of disabled drivers, little economy to help us. Instead, we just want to sue everybody. And then I want to know where Access Chicago is when certain areas, because most of the people that are making this lawsuit, you live downtown. Well, if you live downtown, the sidewalk issues aren't a problem for you.
Yeah.
My family's in the suburbs of Chicago. We still got sidewalk issues. General sidewalk issues. But y'all want to sue Uber, though. So, and I'm not, as far as living in Dallas, like, I'm thoroughly convinced that, I mean, Texas ranks last as far as ADA accessibility goes. But it's just like, we worry about the wrong things. And this is before I started learning about, through you and Keith, I started learning about police brutality. Because I started dealing with my issues with the cops. They didn't really know that I was disabled until one instance, which, hence the name of the channel. But, you know, I just kind of feel like the model of advocacy in our country is not right. And I'm sure the same way is overseas as well. Because no one seems to care about, no one seems to really be out there, you know, on the forefront to really see, okay, what's wrong with the country and what's not wrong with the country. And accessibility is like a major thing. And accessibility along color lines is a real major thing. So, let's see. You mentioned your dad. I wanted to ask you about, do you have a link with, like, the Black Panthers, or does your family have a link to that? How did that?
I think my father, you know, it's always a great area, but I think my father worked with the Black Panthers back in the 70s and early 60s.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if he was a Black Panther, but I know that he worked with the party.
Right. So was there a lot of activism in your family?
My father was an activist. My mom really pushed everything for me, you know. Of course, you know, it's always a common story that, you know, disabled kids, that their mother is really the advocate for them.
Yeah.
And, yeah, my mom pushed me to be mainstream, and back in the 70s, this is when, you know, IDEA was just coming out, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, she pushed for mainstreaming, you know, she pushed for, you know, physical therapy when I needed it. You know, she got me into nonprofits. That's the first, you know, first time I got into nonprofits, I was a teenager.
Mm-hmm.
You know, used to volunteer in nonprofits and stuff like that, so. So yeah, my mom was really an advocate for me, and my dad was a community activist, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So is it, which came first, the career as an artist or as a poet or an activist?
Yeah, I get that question a lot. I think both of them came, well, let me be true and honest.
Mm-hmm.
Being black and disabled back in the late 70s and 80s, you spend a lot of time alone. Yeah. So I spend a lot of time alone writing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's when I started writing poetry and short stories. You know, I kept it to myself, but that's when I started writing.
So you just... And let me see if I got the name of the book correctly. Black Cripple Delivers Poetry and Lyrics. That book just came out last year, right?
Yeah.
And it, because I, again, just following your progress on Facebook, I saw a lot of book tours. Is that your first book?
Yeah, it was my first official copyright book, yeah. With the Library of Congress stamp on it.
Yeah.
I mean, I used to do chat books back in the day in the early 90s, you know, when poetry was really hot here in the Bay Area.
Mm-hmm.
You know, poets used to go to Kinko's and do a little book, you know, but, you know, there wasn't, you know, quote unquote, official book.
Yeah. So that book was basically a lifetime of writings, or just recent.
Yeah. You know, a lot of stuff I lost because a lot of stuff was written before computers. So a lot of that stuff I lost, but and of course I couldn't put anything in the book. As a matter of fact. Me and my publisher went back and forth. I had to literally, like, I think 100 poems. So, yeah.
Wait, you had 100 poems originally?
No, I had to eliminate 100.
Wow.
I had a lot, so.
Wow, that's...
Yeah, my phone is like, you know, you can say that for the next book, so, yeah.
I know, right? That's prolific. How often do you write?
You know, it comes and it goes. You know, I don't push it nowadays. Last thing I wrote was a song lyric.
Mm.
And, you know, I wrote a song about... this disabled woman that was a hip hop artist, so I wrote a poem song about that, and that was like about 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so you know, I write other things. I write, you know, I do a lot of interviews.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I write. You know, articles. So that's what I write. And behind this book, I'm really excited to talk about this book. I'm doing a children's book. It's going to come out hopefully in February. And it's called Black Disability Art History 101.
Mm-hmm.
So it goes all the way back to the blues until now. So it has musicians, visual artists, actors, and singers, dancers, yeah. So it's a children's book, so it's really for children.
And that's like a children's book, but it's focused on history?
Yeah, Black Disability Art History, so yeah. because it blues to painting, to dancing, to you know, other artists. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, what? So, as a rapper, as a career as a rapper, were you just kind of, because you're a poet and rap is basically poetry. As far as that goes, were you performing, or were you kind of just, did you start performing when you linked up with Keith, or were you performing independently?
I'm a poet, and, you know, like you said, poetry is rap, but, you know, people call me a rapper because, you know, I do poetry over hip-hop beats, but I really consider myself a poet. And I started coming out and doing poetry in the early 90s.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, I started when I was in the U.K., but I was like, yeah, I don't know nobody here, so it's easy to get up on stage and do something.
Right, right.
So that's when I started coming out and came back here in the late 90s. The poetry scene in the Bay Area was hot.
Mm-hmm.
It was really hot. So I and Poor Magazine, you started what's called the Poor Poets. And we, you know, did poetry all over the Bay Area. I also was a part of the Molotov Mouse, this poetry group. Mm-hmm. And we born, and we went to Canada and everywhere. So yeah, I've been out as a public woman's performer since the 90s.
Okay. Then now, was that like a mini career for you, or was it just a labor of love? Were y'all just kind of...
Well, everything I do is a labor of love. You know, I don't see things as a 9-to-5 job. You know, everything I do is a labor of love. You know, I still do poetry. You know, mostly I do it in like schools and colleges, and, you know, venues that can pay me, you know, because I did my open mic days, you know, and, you know, sometimes I go back to it, but, you know, I did that, right. So, yeah.
That's cool. Now, I actually heard the Cripcast radio show about a couple weeks ago. And you had mentioned...
What radio show?
I think it was called the Cripcast radio show.
Oh, yeah, in the UK.
Yeah. You had mentioned, and I didn't know this, did you start your advocacy career in the UK?
No, it's weird. I found, when I was there in the UK for the first time in the 90s, like 95, I found what's called a Black Disabled Movement.
Mm-hmm.
So when I ran into it, I was like, holy shit, you know, because I've always, since I was a little boy, always brought up race and disability. Mm-hmm. You know, I was involved with, you know, disability organizations and ADAPT, you know, disability protests. And I looked around, and it was like, you know, I was the only Black person there. And that was in the 80s, you know. So I've always had race and disability, you know, in my mind.
Right.
So the UK, especially in London, had a Black disabled movement. And, you know, I read about that here, you know, before I went there.
Mm-hmm.
And when I went there, I was so mad because I was there, you know, when it was almost ready to end, you know.
Yeah. So you weren't you weren't there toward the beginning.
No, I wasn't there toward the beginning.
Wow. But that kind
of that's why I say that London really changed my focus because I came back here. I quit my job. I was working at a nonprofit. It just a whole nonprofit. I quit my job. I started, you know, my own organization for people of color with disabilities. And I started to, you know, write more and be, you know, and come out as a poet more because I saw black disabled poets on stage, you know, in London. So I was like, holy cow, you know.
Yeah. You're kind of like, wow, that's a different thing.
It's like, you know, James Baldwin going to Paris and just finding, you know, a whole total different world.
Yeah, like, because when I heard that, when I heard that part of the interview, I was like, wait a minute, there was a big movement in the UK? Wow, because the disability rights movement here, it's almost like we don't have a, it's almost like we barely have a voice right now.
Well, you know what, I think, and tell you the truth, let's go back, I think what happened to the disability rights movement, mm-hmm. when they were really, you know, activism and, you know, protesting and stuff,
mm-hmm.
I think what happened is that, you know, like everything else, it became more nonprofits. And, you know, when you become more nonprofits, it becomes more services and less activism. So now you have, you know, a lot of services, and that's good. But you really, what, there's little activism.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that one thing that happened, you know, people got into nonprofits, they didn't get used to these grants, get used to getting paid and stuff. And number two, I think activism in the disability community is not really radical, you know. It's all about, you know, me too.
Right.
It's not about, you know, taking over the system. You know, and I think that's why that's why I started my own organization back in the '90s for people of color with disabilities. And after that was done, I hooked up with a friend of mine, Patty Byrne, here in Berkeley. And we started what's called Sins and Valleys because we are both people of color with very radical politics on race and disability. And we didn't see that in the disability community.
Mm-hmm.
So we started our own stuff, you know.
Yeah. I think the divide that I'm seeing, because I'm 34, so
okay.
The divide that I'm seeing right now is a lot of, like, we're not being, what people used to think of as, like, disability rights is different because we have the ADA now, and as much as I have issues with how, and I'm not going to say it's broken, but I say it's broken amongst my friends, but it's incomplete. And I think a lot of people because we're not getting put in homes anymore, we're not getting experimented on anymore, although that's coming with some of the things I'm reading about shortening, like, you know, bodies and making, you know, disabled people smaller.
Just for care
purposes. And I think people with cerebral palsy, because we both have it, that's going to be affected. They're going to be affected the most. But I think that, like, the biggest issue with disability rights in a larger scheme is, you know, not accessibility, but, like, inspiration porn and, you know, representation. Because some of us are because we get some of us get funneled into like the government system where after you graduate, there's a government program that'll help you get a job. So there's a lot of people with disabilities that don't. There's a lot of people with disabilities that are working, and they're like, well, I don't really know about the working situation because I'm fine. So what the activism is now is it's personal. And I think that's what you were getting at with the me first aspect, because it's like everybody's trying to get one leg up and try to get, you know, comfortable. And then it's like, well, if you don't want to be in the system, like, if you don't want to be in the system and you don't want to be like DARS or whatever, and you still need assistance, it's like you don't really have a leg to stand on. And I'm seeing with a lot of, and I think with the disability too white hashtag that Ramp Up Your Voice started, I think it was an eye opener for some people, because it's hard to explain to a white disabled person their white privilege, because they've been kicked around by ableism so much they can't see it. So it's like, okay, when she did the hashtag, everybody, like, she got a lot of backlash. From what I read, she got a lot of backlash from advocacy groups and white disabled people. And it's like, well, what she's saying is right, though. The movement really doesn't include us. The representation isn't there. And everybody's kind of, like, on their own thing. Like, you know, like, I can care less about handicapped parking or whether you can park your van, you know, close to your mall. Like, my people can't get a job, or my city is not accessible. Like, let's work on a solution instead of just we're having an award dinner and nobody's getting any money thrown into anything.
Well, I think one is that and I go back to Patty Byrne and Cinder Valid, and the thing about the disability rights movement is like, yeah, we got rights, you know, which is good, and I'm not saying that, but we have to go from disability rights to disability justice. Mm. And disability justice is a total different thing, and because we don't live our lives in the courtroom, you know?
Right.
Like, you know, how can I talk about ADA when you get shot by the police? You know, it's like, you know, so I think that transition has to happen, you know, very quickly, that, you know, that we really have to kind of on disability justice, you know, in what that is, you know, like everyday living, you know, from police brutality to hate crimes to, you know, you really, really taking apart the system and really looking at it and saying, okay, these people in D.C. have been there since day one, and we're still not, you know, we're still getting killed. So we really need to, I don't believe in reform either, you know. I believe that we have to come out with a whole new system.
From the police brutality, because you're doing a lot of work, and I actually wanted to mention, I think when we linked up on Facebook a couple of years ago through Heather Watkins, Where is Hope?
Yeah.
Documentary was. It either just came out, or you were doing a lot of marketing for it. You were doing a lot of social media for them. Could you go into like that project and how you got involved in it?
Well, the thing is that I've been involved with police brutality since the late 80s.
Mm-hmm.
You know, going back to my father was an activist, and, you know, my father was protesting, you know, from police brutality to everything in the black community. And I think that really separated my involvement with the disability race with it. Because I saw black disabled people being killed by the police. And so when I go to, I went to, you know, a gap back in the 80s, they were talking about curb cuts. I was like, dude, because I'm getting shot when I go outside, you know?
Right, I don't give a damn about curb cuts. I'm trying to avoid
it. I was like, dude. So that really changed my, you know, and that was in the 80s, you know. So I've been doing police brutality stuff since like 89, 88. You know, of course now it's more, you know, cultural activism, you know, because I really, you know, physically with PT, once you hit 39, you really can't, I really can't do protests no more, you know. Right. Even as a matter of fact, you know, all these Donald Trump protesting, I was like, yeah, but I can't walk around in circles all night, and, you know, I just can't do that no more. You know, I write an article about it, you know. I write a poem about it, I write a song about it, but right. I can't.
The heart is there, but the body is not.
You know, the body is not. And even with that, I think, you know, people have the right to protest. Yeah, protest. And me and my friend got in an argument about it. It's like, a protest was a mission. Yeah. You know, yeah. Protest when you're shouting at empty buildings and you're just walking on in circles.
Yeah.
You know, come on, man. I'm 49 years old. I'm not going to do that no more. Yeah. Hell yeah. I'll protest if we're going to, you know, to Donald Trump Hotel downtown San Francisco, you know, in broad daylight. But I'm not going to just, you know, walk in circles and block traffic for 4 hours.
No. And then what makes me laugh about the protesters is like, you want to protest, but then when you disturb the peace and when you block traffic and when you clearly do something that warrants you getting arrested, then it's like, okay, this is not going to be, this isn't cool anymore. They're putting the cuffs on me. And I'm wearing my college sweater, my life is over, and you start crying. And it's like, come on, man. Like, don't go down there protesting. I saw that in Dallas when Eric Gardner got killed, and we were doing protests for that. And I was like, why are you down here protesting, and then when something happens, you don't know what to do? You know what I'm saying? It's like, okay, you can protest, but be prepared for the consequences of that. And
it's how you organize the protests. A lot of times, and I say this a lot, and that's the one reason that I don't protest no more. I do little stuff. I don't big stuff. Is that a lot of times people with disabilities are left behind. And they get messed up by the police. I saw it. I've been there. I've been in those situations.
Mm-hmm.
So once again, it's like the protests or the organizers are not looking out for the people. It's like, I saw people get flipped over in their wheelchairs by police because they were left in the back of the rally. You know?
Yeah. So I was gonna ask you, because you mentioned, everybody mentions Black Lives Matter and how they're kind of forgetting or they're kind of sweeping under the rug the disability component of it. And I actually want to ask you another question with that. But I was thinking, like, well, maybe, because people are like, well, why don't you see disabled people in the protest? And I think you had mentioned that they don't really include us. And I was just going to say, should we just go? Should we just, like, get the people that want to protest, should disabled people should just go to these rallies and just kind of make our voice be heard. But now you're saying people are getting flipped over, and it's been your experience that it's kind of like a dangerous proposition to just, to, you know, exercise our civic duty to protest. It's like, man, I don't even want to try to do that now.
Black Lives Matter, I can talk forever about Black Lives Matter. But, since Invalid tried to really get Black Lives Matter into disability justice, they had one big phone on video conference about that, mm-hmm. two years ago. But it wasn't followed up, and we tried to get them to follow up. Because it's not about including people with disabilities. It's like you have to sit down and really listen and take a workshop on what disability justice is and how does it look like in your movement. We're not like an add-on.
Right.
So when I saw that a couple of years, it's like, dude, they're not even willing to have the conversation.
Is it?
And so when their platform came out, and a lot of black disabled people were upset about their platform, which I totally agree with, their platform had nothing to do with disabilities.
Right.
Although they said that they heard a couple of disabled people that were educating on the platform, you could tell the language alone and like differently abled. That's like, what? The language alone is not. It didn't come from our community. So, it's like, from Cinder Valley to their platform, it just tells me that they're not ready for it to have a really sit down conversation that will change their institutional thinking when it comes to disability. So if you're not ready for that, then we just have to do it ourselves. As a matter of fact, since the Valley and other people have been doing rallies on their own, where we put a rally, we talk about what disability justice looks like in a rally. So we make the rally accessible. We make sure that there's people looking out for other people. Make sure that there's sign language interpreters. So, yeah.
Do you think that as far as like the police brutality thing, and you mentioned also the school to prison pipeline affecting people with disabilities, but a lot of it is hidden disabilities or disabilities that you can't really tell, like autism. I know the black deaf community are victims as well. A lot of times with my dealings with the police, and thankfully nothing serious has happened, it's always been in cars with friends, and no one really noticed that I was disabled until, they told us to get out the car, and I'm like, I have cerebral palsy. Like, I make different movements than everybody else. I've only had one situation where I was in my wheelchair and the guy stopped me. And my question to you is, do you think that Black Lives Matter and the disability component of police brutality isn't talked about because people's idea of disability means like physical or something you can see, and they don't really take into the account you know, the psychological disabilities or the mental health disabilities that affect us differently than our white counterparts?
Well, no, I think one, and it's hard to say this, so I'll just say it, that disability is not a pretty issue.
Yeah.
You know, so it's not a mainstream pretty issue. So people, you know, don't want to be on the platform. That's number one. Number two is that all what's out there in the mainstream media, the mainstream public, tells activists and even parents to have a hush-hush thing about disability. Right. I've been in so many cases, this is before it gets public and all the rallies. But I've been in so many cases where parents didn't want to bring up disability in a case because they thought it's going to weaken their case, and they thought it's shame of it. I'm not blaming the parents, but I'm saying that kind of mindset is everywhere. And if you look at cases, that's the key issue of the case, is that the person wants to say, well,
exactly.
Well, you don't want to bring it up because, you're ashamed of it. And it goes down, it happens to the parents, then it goes to the media, and disability is erased, so you don't know that the person has a disability. Then it goes into the law, and the lawyers don't know the person has a disability. So we're being erased from every platform.
Right.
So how can people fight for it when it's erased from the beginning?
Right.
And when we have that attitude that, disability is a hush-hush issue, and B, it's not a point-blank issue, and three, that people don't talk to disabled activists or community scholars that have a disability, that have a really disability positive attitude, so they can flip that kind of thinking. So, all that together in one big ball, it's just,
Wow.
It's like, wow. And the thing about it is that it's so freaking, stresses me out, is that over 70% of the cases are people with disabilities.
That's like,
forget about Black Lives Matter, but how about October 22nd, all these other police activist groups that's been around way before Black Lives Matter. They still don't talk about disability. It's like, how can you not talk about it when there's 70% of the cases are people with disabilities? It's just amazing.
I think as part of our identities, like when you're Black and you're disabled, they intertwine. So for us, it's like, as much as I want to be seen as just a Black man, everybody sees my disability first. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, they're intertwined. We always try to fight.
If you have a physical disability, yeah.
And I think with, if you start looking at, like, man, if you see something like where that, and I think it was in, I don't know if it was in Berkeley or I think it was in San Francisco, that situation with the Black cop, he stomped out that Mexican kid with cerebral palsy because the kid, they got into an altercation, the kid spit at him. Now, that whole, when that, I'm sure you know about that case, the particulars. For,
in the school?
Yeah.
Yeah.
When that happened, it was, I know locally they tried to flip it and they tried to like say that the kid was a jerk and stuff.
Yeah.
But from a national standpoint, everybody was like, wow, like you beat up a kid in a wheelchair. You know what I'm saying? Where the disability is like there. You know what I mean? And it's like now, you know, because that cop will never work again because you physically are watching somebody beat up a kid in a wheelchair. No matter how jerky the kid was, that's something that they're seeing. But when you start, like the guy in Tulsa, Oklahoma, we found out that like he's deaf out of one ear, and he has a glass eye. We found that out later.
Yeah.
And they didn't want to say anything. Like originally when that happened, they didn't want to say anything. I think it changes the narrative if we start focusing on, you know, disability first. That changes the narrative. Whereas before, it's whenever a black person gets shot, they always want to try to blame the person. Well,
oh yeah, well that's coming from the police side, of course.
And that's
the police story, you know.
And the media. So
yeah.
I think one of the reasons why they try to hide it. I mean, the parents, true. I'm not saying what you're saying is wrong, because I think with a lot of parents, they, I don't know, it's weird, because our parents kind of treated us differently, where it was, because my mom basically raised me as like, you have a disability, but it doesn't matter, you still got to do what you got to do.
Yeah.
I think with a lot of parents, I don't know if there's a shame there, I don't know what's going on, but... And then with the media, because the narrative has always been victim caused the problem, if you mention disability, there's a like, well, they should have known better. So it like strengthens the narrative of our, I guess, negligence or our whatever it is. Because there's still an attitude in this country of black people being uppity when it comes to police brutality. Like, there's something we could have did to prevent the police brutality from happening. And sometimes...
Well, I think it becomes that because the first story out of the gate is the police story.
Right.
So it changes our focus all around because we're seeing the story from one side.
Right.
So after the activists get on it, it's on Facebook, we think, oh, okay, this is the other side, okay?
Right.
You know, but we don't get the time to get the other side out. We just take what the police says and think, oh, he shouldn't be doing that.
What made you, because you're originally from New York, right?
Yeah, New York and Connecticut.
Okay. And you went to school in Notre Dame.
Yeah.
For political science, right?
Yeah.
What was your career aspirations for with your political science degree? Were you just
I was going to law school. I took the LSAT like 3 times.
Mm-hmm.
So I was going to go to law school until I went to the UK, and that's when I found the Black Panther movement, that's when I came out as a poet, so I came back and I was like, you know, free to law school. And you know, my family's like, why? You know, so...
Do you think you would have been able to do more... do you think you're able to do more as an advocate and the work that you do now versus you going to law school?
Yeah, I think so too. I think I do more now. You know, when I started the organization, that down with myself. I was like, okay, anyway, this is the road, you know. You're on this road, you know. And I was, you know, I was offered, you know, 9-to-5 job at a law firm. I was offered all this stuff. But I realized when I was working in the nonprofit space before I started my own, I used to come home sick. I used to be tired a lot. And my sister, Melissa, she's like, Leroy, you're not doing what you want to do. You're not writing. You're not doing what you want to do. So that changed my whole future plans, you know. That's when I quit the nonprofit and I started my own nonprofit, you know. Now, doing my artwork and my activism 24/7, you know, just made a decision that, you know, I didn't want to go back to working in 9-to-5 and going to law school and all that stuff. You know, it's hard as hell, man. You know, but I think I'm more happy, and I think my work has made a change in people. You know, Krip Hop put out, like I said, 3 CDs. Our last CD was around police brutality against people with disabilities. It was the first and only CD of its kind that did that.
Right.
You know, so in the film, you know, I'm glad that the work that I do now, you know. I mean, going to South Africa in a couple of weeks, you know, that didn't come from a grant. It came from just me just working and networking, you know.
How did you, because you did that by choice. I'm kind of going through the same journey, but it's more circumstance, and it's scary because I have an interdisciplinary studies degree, so it's sociology, political science. I'm a graphic designer by trade, and I've worked for the federal government. I was one of those disabled people that made it. Like, I got the WRP selection out of college, and I started working at this government agency. And for the first 2 years, it was awesome because I was actually kind of doing what I wanted to do. And then it became like, okay, we want to put you in this box. We want to have you in, you know, as part of our statistic or whatever. And they asked me to join like the disability group there, but it really wasn't anything. And then it was kind of like my job was basically not what I wanted to do. And I got fired. And for the past like 2 years, I've been, you know, because you got to work to eat. And
yeah,
you know what I'm saying? So I've been doing like just random jobs and random call center jobs, which isn't a negative thing, but now it's like I've kind of stumbled on this YouTube thing, and I'm seeing a space that isn't really filled right now as far as like disability talks, especially as black men with disabilities, because there are some black women that are out there doing it, and it's scary, man. And when you mentioned your journey as far as like not being in the system and kind of doing your own thing, like, because I'm kind of doing it by circumstance, and it's scary. How did you?
Oh, yeah, that was scary. It's not walking the park, it's scary. I mean, I live, to tell you the truth, I live on SSI, I live in a 6-8 apartment.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm single with no kids, you know, and, you know, I'm on the college circuit, so I get lectures at colleges, you know, that and he, so yeah, I mean, my life is really tight, but on the other side, I get to do things like go to South Africa. I get to do things like put out a movie,
experience was pivotal, huh?
Yeah, totally.
How
totally.
Old were you when you went there?
Oh, God, I don't know. It was, 96? And what, I'm 49 and I'm 49 now. Oh, I don't know. In my late 20s, I guess.
Wow. So do you have any regrets, or you're pretty set as far as happiness and like doing what you want to do?
You know, I wish that I read about people getting, fellowships to do this and do that. I do wish that, that people would give me a fellowship, and I don't, it's kind of cocky, but that's like, why should I apply? The work is there. The product is there.
Your foundation, and you already paid your dues already. There's no
reason. Yeah, it's there. I do get kind of jealous when I see that people are getting big time grants to do such and such. But beyond that,
expensive places in the country too.
Oh yeah, California. Although people call it the disabled Mecca, which is it has its dark side too. So it's not a utopia kind of thing for people with disabilities in Berkeley.
Yeah, that's what I know about Chicago too. Because everybody talks about Chicago, and I'm like, okay, I get you, but there's a lot of stuff that we have to deal with too.
Yeah, and especially now with the high gentrification, the Bay Area is like the Mecca for gentrification. It's off the hook.
Really?
I mean, you don't know, pay like $4,000 a month, every month for like a 2-bedroom apartment. I mean, it's off the chain.
Did you say $4,000 a month?
$4,000, that's on the high end. $4,000 a month. And then that's in like San Francisco, here in Berkeley, it could be $3,000 a month.
Wow, that's...
I know,
crazy, man. Like,
it's all the team. It's all the team. I mean, I moved here. I moved to San Francisco in 1991. Me and my sister were living together in San Francisco, and we were paying, like $1,000 in rent. Now in San Francisco, you can't get a closet, you can't get a garage for $1,000.
Wow, they're gentrifying everything here in Dallas, but now I see why everybody from LA and everybody from California is coming down here. Cause,
oh really?
Yeah, like, man, the apartment that my first apartment out of college, it was my senior year. It was like halfway through my junior year. My first apartment, like, away from my mom in Dallas was like $425 a month. And it was a junior one bedroom. It was like in the heart of North Dallas, which is actually pretty good. And now that apartment is like $700 now. And they told me basically, like, everybody from New York and California is coming here. So the market went up. And we haven't gotten to $3,000 a month yet, but we're at $1,000. Like, right now, I'm paying about $700 for an efficiency, and it serves its purpose. But I was like, I remember when everything used to be half of that, and it's like now, it's like you have to work, and you kind of have to hope that they continue doing the increases, because I'm kind of half and half with living off of Social Security. Like, I'll work for a few months and then I'll get back on it, or I'll work like a basic job to kind of supplement myself.
The thing for me, I say here, is that I live on 6 and 8, so my portion of the rent is only like $280.
Yeah.
So, and also, like everybody on SSI, you got to.
Yeah, I know.
You can't just live on SSI and just be okay, you know?
Yeah, I think that it's like 7-something now, and I'm like, I can't live off. I gotta work, or I gotta do something else, or... Because you have to. It's like...
Yeah, you have to. Yeah.
How did they expect any of us to actually function off of what they give us is amazing.
Yeah.
I actually have like two more questions, because we've been talking for about a good half hour and a half. And I really appreciate it, man. It's been awesome. But two questions. You are doing... You're starting a... a national interdisciplinary studies, what is it called? National Disability Studies, Black National Disability Studies. I'm totally killing the name right now, but it's a college course?
Or a college course? Yeah, well, it's part of the National Black Disability Coalition.
Mm-hmm.
And it's Jane Dunham in New Jersey, myself, and other people.
Mm-hmm.
And we've done other projects, and we really wanted to really focus on one thing and really concentrate on that thing. And that one thing now is getting Black disability studies into colleges.
Mm-hmm.
So we work on that, and I think one way that we're doing it now. From now until whenever, is just going to colleges and talking about it. So we might have a gig in New Jersey coming up next school year. Because I've been on the college circuit since 1998, people know me, so I've been connecting them to the National Black Display Coalition.
Mm-hmm.
So we really want to want to partner with a couple of colleges and just like start like a pilot program on their campus.
Are you focusing on NBCUs or
specifically? I mean, right now we just want, you know, a really strong partner that can do it. That's why we're going to campuses and talking about it first. After that talk, you know, we need to see, you know, how many campuses are really want to take it on. You know, HBCUs, you know, it's so funny. It's so strange. It's so weird. I've been on the college circuit as a lecturer since, what, 98. Mm-hmm. And I haven't got one call from the HBCU. Not
really?
One. Not one.
Wow.
I mean, I've been at Harvard, I've been at Yale, I've been at, you know, UC Berkeley, I've been not everywhere, but I've been to, like, big time schools, and not one from an HBCU.
So the work is there. It's not like they don't know who you are.
No.
Wow. The ableism in the black community is astounding. That makes that kind
of... Oh my God, oh my God, what are you talking about? Oh my God, it is off the chain.
That touched the nerve with me, man, because the work is there. Like, they could easily, especially now, like, they really need... They need that, you know, especially now with police brutality and everybody kind of not really knowing what to do, you know, like, that's amazing that Morehouse, none of them, like.
I mean, for me, I'm talking about for me, you know, calling me to come on the campus, not one of them. I've been on the college circuit since 98. Mm-hmm. So my name's out there, you know. It's just, especially this year and last year, because, you know, my book came out, the documentary came out, you know. So I'm putting out more projects. So I thought, you know, after all that I would be getting more calls from HBCUs, but no. It's just amazing. Like, are you serious? Yeah.
I guess. That's. How did you get involved with the National Black Disability Coalition?
Well, Jane Dunham, a really good friend of mine, came here in the early 2000s. I was a part of, and she knew my work from race and disability, because I also am a writer for Poor Magazine and also the San Francisco Bayview newspaper. It's a black newspaper. Mm-hmm. So she knew my work, you know, before we met. So when we met, you know, I was involved with it's called Harambe. Harambe was an African American parent organization for disabled youth. So I got involved, and one year Jane came down to talk to Harambe, and that's how we met face to face. And after that, 2 years later, you know, her run being folded, and Jane was doing an organization in New Jersey for black disabled people, and I came out to New Jersey having the Reading Awards for Black disabled, you know, activists, or Black disabled people that they're doing something in the communities. So I came out and did that. So we've been in really, our work really it overlaps because, you know, she's a mother with a disabled daughter, and she's always been an activist around Black disability issues. Mm-hmm. So our work really, you know, fell into each other's lap, and that's how we met. And I think it was 3 years ago, she wanted to do a national organization for Black disabled people. Mm. It's like, yeah. Because really, there's not one national organization for Black disabled people. Mm. You know, we of course, we got the NAACP, you know, we got all these disabled national organizations, but not one for Black disabled people.
Have the national disabled organizations, have they reached out to you over the years, or is it just kind of like sporadic?
They come and go. You know, I think they reach out just to see, you know, what we're doing, and then they're all greater, you know. So they don't reach out as to, you know, oh, let's collaborate or let's do it together. They just reach out to say, oh, it's, you know, what you're doing and all that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But and also, because once again, the nonprofit structure, it's all about, you know, funding turf. You know? Mm-hmm. It's like people are scared once you put, you know, a national Black disabled organization together, because you're messing with their funding. There's a lot of these nonprofits get funding to do outreach to the Black community. Mm-hmm.
So, how are you going to, because you mentioned you started a not-for-profit yourself, how is your not-for-profit different, and how is the National Black Disability Coalition different than regular not-for-profits?
Well, back when I started my non-profit, it was way before the National Black Disability Coalition. I mean, my non-profit was back in, 1995, 1996.
Mm-hmm.
So, it was called DMO, Disability Advocates of Minorities Organization. DMO was for people of color with disabilities. So, we also, because I was and I'm still a poet, we had an artistic arm to DMO. It really took off. I think that took off more than the organization.
Mm-hmm.
We had an artistic arm called Disabled Poets and Artists of Color. We used to come together and just do readings and poetry events around the Bay Area. What DAMO, I think DAMO stands apart from the Black National Disability Organizations, like, for one, like, for people of color, and for two, we were really deep into the Bay Area community. So we got our first grant to do this campaign to bring disabled people of color together. And that their campaign led to, you know, the rallies that we did, and led to, you know, going to the Capitol and speaking out on racism in the disability community, where when, you know, a lot of people didn't like that, but we did it, you know.
Right.
So, yeah. Well, that, yeah, that was from, what, 96 until, I don't know, 99 or something like that.
So I had a good 3-year run.
Yeah, 3-4 year run. I think what happened is that toward the end, you know, like any nonprofit, I was becoming a grant writer and just doing the program. I don't want to do this. You know, just write grants all the time.
So you basically wanted to be out there with the people.
Yeah, I want to be out there with people, and also my cultural side was really coming out. My poetry, my, you know, Krip Hop was just about to begin there. I was just thinking about it, you know, at the time. I was writing more, so that really, you know, over, you know, yeah, came my focus. And plus, keeping a board together was so freaking hard. Oh my god. We went to the board members, like, no way, you know, like, 2 board members left. We had to get a board, we had to get 2 more on board. It was hard. It was really hard.
Was it because of, like, they just wanted to do other things? Was it because they didn't have the patience to see it grow? Like,
I think they didn't have the patience to see it grow. You know, people, especially now, even back then, people used to be being in nonprofits that already, you know, has the foundation and being grants, that has a department of, you know, grant, and has a department of that and that. So, you know, demo was grassroots. It was, you know, we were just starting out. Mm-hmm. We didn't have that, you know. And it wasn't a pretty thing, you know. It wasn't a pretty thing. We talked about police brutality and unemployment, and, you know, when we put on the EDA rally, oh my god. People freaked out. I mean, oh my god, I had this. Remember the cover of the EDA?
Mm-hmm.
So I took the cover of the EDA and copied it, and I put on the top page, who is missing from the picture. And it's just kind of like all white people, you know. Oh my god, so the disability elite at the time needed to be here again like that at all. I mean, oh,
you're not arousing. You're starting trouble. You're not allowed to start trouble.
Well, it's true. I mean, the picture is so true. I still use that picture in my workshop, you know?
Oh, that's awesome. Like, what's missing from this picture? All the brown people. Yeah, man. Like, I think I think representation of us, and like I said, we're not counted, and then people really don't see, like, the struggles that we go through as minorities. And then, like, I always do a state of the union when I do Facebook posts when the ADA does. And it started when I was the 25th celebration. And every year when I do my long post on it, and you saw it this year, there's always, like, white disabled people that make it a deal. And I'm like, okay, but you're a white disabled person, and like, you don't understand like the stuff that we have to go. Like, there's a difference. There's a difference between your world, your disabled world, and mine. And I try to let everybody know, like, everybody's like path, everybody's disabled experience is different. And we don't. And instead of, and I just think, well, one of the things that I'm seeing, you know, and I'm just not necessarily learning, but I'm just kind of new to the advocacy thing as far as writing and as far as vlogging. I feel like sometimes, like you were saying about police brutality, you know, and you're going to adapt and you're like, they're talking about curb cuts and you're like, well, my people are getting shot at. You know, and my biggest thing is employment, like, and access. Like, we still have a big issue with access in this country, and with serious access and discrimination and ableism and real ableism, like systematic ableism. And I'm like, I don't care about the Me Before You movie. Like, I don't. Like, you know, like, there are real police brutality things that we could be protesting. I'm not trying to protest the movie. You know what I'm saying? Like I love it. I love y'all, you know, fervor, but it's like, okay, can we fix the unemployment situation with us? Because my biggest thing is, my biggest issue has always been jobs. And now it's just like, when that was happening, I was just learning about the police brutality thing, and I'm reading all these pieces about disability rights or disability like theory, and I'm like, okay, assisted suicide is a thing, but police brutality is a thing, discrimination is a thing. Like, why are we protesting? We got more angry about the Me Before You movie than we did about anything else, than we did about police brutality and people with disabilities getting shot. Yeah, that.
I think nowadays, and it's hard to say this, but nowadays with social network, everybody is about I. You know, it's about, oh, look at this article that I did, or look at this project that I did. So it's not about a we thing anymore, you know?
Going back to what you said earlier.
Well, you know, I look at my father's days, you know, my dad. And I think one thing was wrong now. The nonprofit system took over all of our lives. All of it. So my dad back in the '70s, he said, "Oh yeah, I go to work, then I come home and I do my activism on the side."
Yeah.
Today it's like, oh no, we're at work. My nonprofit is my activism. So my social work is my activism. So you don't have another site to come home to.
Right.
And I think that's what changed our activism. That changed everything.
Yeah.
I didn't go in there and nonprofit, do my work, and came home and did my activism work.
Have people ever like looked at your work and said, I can't ride with them?
Oh my god, hell yeah. I mean, Krip Hop alone, oh, people couldn't ride with it. I mean, even hip hop artists with disabilities now, they can't ride with Krip Hop because it's not a bling bling kind of thing. You know, it's not a label, we're not gonna be on MTV, so people that see that, and people that are not really comfortable in disability justice and activism don't want to hang with us.
Right.
They go on your legs, you know. So yeah, so that in the crib outside, they don't want to hang in the activism side. Especially around police brutality.
Mm-hmm.
because I'm going a lot deeper than just, you know, training. You know, I'm going deeper than just settlement, which is cool for the family. I know I'm not saying don't do it, but I'm saying let's go deeper and bring back our own power as a community. And I'm looking for a system to give me answers. I'm looking for our community to do the answers that we have the capable of doing. So because of that, a lot of people don't want to hear him because, you know, I think they're comfortable of, you know, being a part of the system and having that bling and, you know, TV coming out and they interview you and you talk about police training and if they need to be even more than that.
When you're a rapper and when you're trying to be an artist, like, being part of the system is safe, man. It's good to have health insurance.
Yeah, you're a part of the label, you get paid, and, you don't rock the boat because, you know, you get paid.
Right.
You know, and, you know, I'm not saying that's wrong. I'm saying that there's good avenues to go on, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You know, you get freaking 50 cents that bullies people with disabilities and he can come out with an album tomorrow and get paid.
Right.
But Krip Hop is doing, has done 3 CDs and, you know, that's coming from my pocket, not coming from, you know, people that
because, man, it's been 2 hours, and I don't want to take up
any time. That's a lot of work. I used to do that for radio, so I know it's a lot of work.
But, yeah, man, like, so what's next for you? Because the Africa trip is coming. What do we, can we do anything? Is there a crowdfunding thing? Is there a fundraising site that we can go to like, help, if anything?
Well, it's so funny you brought that up because we just got into this big, long fight that happened for 2 months for Indiegogo campaign. And we put out a fundraising page and they didn't want to let go of the funding. So we had to fight for 2 months just to get that funding, and I just got it, you know, yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but they didn't want to give it to us. So, you know, at this time, I'm saying that, you know, if people want to donate, they can just email me, I can just give them my, you know, PayPal account.
PayPal is the best way.
Yeah, so that's one way. That's, you know, one way to do it. And also, you know, beyond donations, just promotion, when I get back, I'm going to do talks all around the Bay Area, around the South Africa trip, you know, if people know, you know, colleges or organizations that want me to come and talk about it, you know, and of course, we would love to have people promote the film when it's out, you know, put it on the website, you know, promote it, you know, get us on radio and stuff. So, that's how people can help.
That's cool, man. So, are you still... Let me ask you something. About the book, Have you ever thought about doing like a national tour with the book or with the poetry?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, poetry doesn't tell that much, unfortunately. When the book came out, I did a couple of readings here, a couple of readings at colleges and stuff. But it's unfortunate, and I hate to say it, but poetry don't sell. So I'm hoping with South Africa film and book, that could push me to do a national tour. But having a national tour means you have sponsors, you have other people that can really back it. Of course I can go campus to campus and do my little thing, but that's not really a national tour, So our 10th anniversary for Krip Hop is coming up next year. We want to do a tour around the U.S., And how we're thinking about doing it is only me and Binky from Germany. And then we will go to cities where Krip Hop artists are already at and do like events there. So they can help plan it and we'll just come and do it, So that's
actually smart.
You know that
there's a pocket there that's receptive and you can build like little satellite bases there. So instead of trying to figure out, okay, would they vibe with us, you're kind of already going where you know there's an acceptance.
Yeah. And at first they wanted to, bring everybody and just go on this road trip and like, and I thought like, that's not gonna work. You should just go to places where people are already at and just perform there. So that's we're looking to do it in the summer. But also looking to do in the summer too is here in the Bay Area is this big. I want to do something really big in the summer for Krip Hop. So I'm looking at having like a concert / presentation. So a concert of Krip Hop artists, presentation of what we did in South Africa. And also, Krip Hop is working with a filmmaker here in Oakland to put out a film about this blind musician that was a music engineer in Oakland back in the 80s. And really, he produced like the top Oakland hip hop groups, like Digital Underground and MC Hammer and all those, and Vogue. His studio in Oakland Hills is one of the accessible studios to go to, and a lot of black artists, musicians at the time used to go to his studio. So he passed away years ago, but we are making a documentary of his life. And then he made it. That project, like the South Africa project, has been four or five year project. First, I met the family in Atlanta, Georgia, and came back, and 2 years ago, we got the Oakland to have a Joe Kubert's month. So now every August in Oakland is Joe Kubert's month. So we're building on it. So now, in August 2017, the film's gonna come out. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's how I do for a project. I build on it. So that is an example of that, you know, we're building on Joe Kubert's legacy, not only about Oakland, but the music, you know. The music scene in Oakland, the music sound in Oakland, you know. Started by a black, the single band, you know.
Yeah. No, that's awesome, man. Like, I kind of wish I was there. Like, that would be really cool, man.
That's one reason why we need a national tour. Yeah. You know? See, that's the thing that you get back and go back to, you know, all these other people out there, like, you know, fellowships and, like, big time grants to do travel and all that stuff, and here, Krip Hop is doing some amazing stuff.
By themselves.
By themselves with no money, you know, that's a bad budget, you know?
And you guys have been doing it for 10 years. Like, what are you guys going to do for the 10-year anniversary, though?
Yeah, one thing is we're doing the tour, hopefully. You know, we're still talking about it. But we are definitely going to do a CD that's going to come out in January. Matter of fact, we just put on the deadline for people to give me their music. But yeah, we're putting out a CD, our 10th annual. Well, the CD's going to celebrate our 10th anniversary.
Did the deadline pass already?
No, it's coming out the 20th.
The 20th of December or the 20th of?
20th of November.
The 20th of November, okay. So we got a week. I gotta do crazy editing now, but this will be
all right.
I might submit something. So if whoever listens to this, if they want to submit something to you, what would be the protocol? Like, email you the MP3 or?
Well, first you have to meet the artists that I got so far are artists that I know. You know, they've been around Krip Hop for 10 years. So artists that I don't know, it's like the person you have to meet, you know, drop me an email, it's called, you know, because, you know, Krip Hop is political, so I just don't want, you know, songs talking about inspiration and all that kind of crap. You know, it's very political and you don't, you know, put down women or put down people that are queer, you know, so we have like a standard of what kind of songs, you know, that we want to have. So it's not, you know, it's not like open to anybody, we'll just take anything, you know.
So you're not, like, does any dude with a disability, whatever they want to talk about, you're just, oh, he got a disability, let's put him on here.
No, I'm too much of an activist to do that.
Man, that 10 years, man, I think I had heard about you guys in like, I heard about you guys 5 years ago, and it was
crazy. Really?
Yeah. And then like that, because I think at the time there was a couple other, there was a few other like groups and collectives, and I think there was a label too. Like that was kind of where.
Oh yeah.
That was kind of where. Then they're kind of past now, but that was kind of where like people were kind of. Social media was just popping, kind of, and everybody had internet connections and stuff. And I was like, okay. So I was kind of seeing a little bit of things going on. And then, like, YouTube was kind of, people were actually using YouTube every day. Or there was more YouTube content. So there's a lot of, there's a lot of rappers that with CP, and there's a lot of rappers with disabilities that were trying to get their name out there. Some of it was good, some of it was not. So I was like, okay. But then, and so when you told me you found it, I was like, I know about Krip Hop Nation. But yeah, man, this was amazing. I've learned a lot. You're really interesting. I totally respect the fact that you quit your job to do, because, man, like, it sounds like to me you pretty much, I don't want to say had it, but you had opportunity, man, to be really comfortable, and you just was like, I can't do it. Like, I gotta do something else.
Yeah, and then, you know, my sister, like I said, my sister's really tall, and it's just like, you're feeling sick, and you're feeling not yourself, because you're not doing what you want to do, you know? As I looked at it, I was like, holy shit, that's so true. You know, so.
Unfortunately for me, like, your sister, my mom has kind of been, like, she's been supportive. Like, I guess when she found out, because I had just been doing sports stuff and little stuff on YouTube, but I'm consistently doing it now. And then when she found out, like, I was doing this, and I told her that you were an activist, she was like, really? I was like, yeah, I'm doing this interview. And she's like, I think the other day she said, I really hope this turns out into something. You know, like, I hope that there's a way that you can kind of monetize everything, because it seems like you're doing well. So, hearing, like, your story, I guess I'm going to push forward. And this is not going to be just a random thing, and I'm just going to give up on it, because you've built something that's pretty dope. And you've built something that's independent of the system, which sometimes is a good thing, because I've heard people talking about certain organizations, and it's like, all they do is deal with dinners. It's like, all we do is have dinners for stuff.
Something else. And I learned that what I love into my 9-to-5, making what I love as a 9-to-5 totally destroys it.
Wow.
Unfortunately.
As I'm embarking on my own like journey, that's scary. But I'm learning and trying to do this, and in trying to do to build this YouTube channel. Like, I'm working a 9-to-5, and I'm working 4 hours every day after this.
See, that's good though. Yeah.
My Saturdays are done. Like, my Sundays are done because they're usually, you know, either I'm interviewing or I'm editing or because there's a sports component too. So I'm watching like games and I'm analyzing games now instead of just watching them as a fan. And it's like, okay, it's still fun, but it's different from watching them as a fan. Like, it's different.
Yeah, totally.
I'm sitting there watching, like, the Philly and Laker game, and I'm like, this is a bad game. But I set up my channel to do a weekly show. And sometimes, like, my co-host, Anthony Johnson, I was too focused on the Cubs series. To really pay attention, and he carried the show in the only way he knows how, because he's kind of out there a little bit, not in a bad way, but he's really energetic, and sometimes he'll go like off the rails, and I was just like, man, I'm gonna keep the majority of this in because like I was not paying attention because I'm focusing on the Cubs, and you carried the show. But when you find, I'm finding that this has kept me sane, man. Because doing this is probably, and you probably know this better than anybody, this is keeping me sane.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure that you building Krip Hop and you going to, you being an activist and you're actually going out there and you're actually doing what you're doing, that's keeping you sane and that's keeping you well.
I think it's really important. I think it's one thing that's been overlooked.
Mm-hmm.
I think it is a time for Black disabled people to get together physically in one spot. I don't know, a national conference or something. You know, I mean, it's cool, you know, we can post stuff, we can talk to people on Facebook, but face-to-face, a national conference on Black disabled people, oh my God, that's one thing. I haven't worked for it, but I hope that the other people will do it. I know for me, I want it, but I've been down that road, so I don't want to.
You don't want to get your hopes up.
Really look at the system and how to really, get Black discipline, pride, you know, and teach about our culture, our history, our arts, hip hop, whatever, you know? Mm-hmm. So those are the two things that I hope people will do. You know, I can help out, but I don't want to leave it, you know?
That would be awesome. I just don't know if we're, the movement itself is like fractured. I just don't know if we're going to be able to do it, because everybody's kind of on their own thing.
But
we can dream. Like, I know if there's ever, like a point where, you know, you can get that together in Berkeley, I'll catch a plane and I'll fly down there, and because that would be awesome. Plus, it would be an excuse for me to see California.
Come on down.
But I guess we'll end it there, man. It was a pleasure. It was an honor. Like, I learned a lot. I don't know how long this is gonna be. We're gonna cut.
I know, okay. You got a lot of work to do, honey.
But it was needed. You know what I'm saying? And I hope that, like, you know, when I share it on social media, I hope people actually get a chance to listen to the whole thing, because it was a lot, and it was eye opening, man. And really, like, your story about your situation. Starting Krip Hop, like, I know what I have to do. Leroy, I will talk to you on Facebook, or if you need some promotion afterwards, you come from South Africa, just let me know, and you know, you'll always have a space here.
Thank you so much.